Terengganu, located on the east coast of Peninsula Malaysia, is also known by its Arabic honorific Darul Iman, abode of faith. There were several versions of how Terengganu got its name. The name was originated from several words which are Taring Anu, Terengganunya, and Terengganu. The name Terengganunya derived from a very bright rainbow seen by a group of travelers and proclaimed the land to be Terengganu, which means bright rainbow. The physical terrain of Terengganu of the states are covered with forests, beaches and various types of flat lands. Terengganu is bordering with Pahang on its southern and western side. The coastline of Terengganu is the longest in Malaysia, stretching out from Besut to Kemaman with a total of 225 km of coastline facing the South China Sea. Kuala Terengganu, the royal capital city of Terengganu, stands at the mouth of broad Terengganu River, is both the state and royal capital as well as the largest city in Terengganu. Kuala Terengganu started as business center and revenue collection from time to time. It is one of the earliest maritime trading cities before the rise of Malacca. In the early days, the economy of Kuala Terengganu was fully dependent on traditional activities such as agriculture, fisheries and trading. However, arrival of colonialism in Malaya, mining a small-scale light industry introduced as one of the socio-economic activities of Kuala Terengganu. The vast majority of Kuala Terengganu's population is ethnically Malay. The Chinese population is more concentrated on the area of Kampung Cina, whilst Indian are in minority. Due to its historical background and geographical location, Terengganu received cultural influences from the Chinese and the neighboring states in the north, Kelantan and Thailand. The assimilation of culture between these people produced local games and handicrafts such as batik, songke, mengkuang and pandanus craft, woodcraft, wow and brassware. Despite its evolution throughout the centuries, the culture and exquisite heritage sites around the royal city of Kuala Terengganu are painstakingly well preserved since it is one of the heritage cities in Malaysia. It is famous for its various cultural tourist attractions such as Pasar Payang, Bazar Warisan and Galeri Seni Warisan that offers variety of the local handicraft. It is also well known for its magnificent heritage sites at Bukit Puteri, Istana Maziah, Masjid Putih and Kota Lama Duyung. Islam started to spread throughout the Nusantara as early as the 13th century. Terengganu is recognized as the first state in Malaysia to receive the teaching of Islam. In 1887, An inscribed stone was found on the banks of Tersat River at Kuala Brown, Terengganu as proof to this statement. History states that an Ahlul Bayt named Sharif Muhammad Al-Baghdadi left Baghdad Kingdom to travel and choose Hulu Terengganu as the place to spread Islam and establish his own kingdom known as Dynasty Al-Kamil before 1290 century. The ruler during this time was called Khalifah. The ruling was then continued by his son, grandson and great-grandson, Sheikh Abdul Malik, or known as Tokku Pulau Manis. Tokku Pulau Manis established an institution for Islamic education in Terengganu. His daughter Siti Zubaidah was married to Tun Jenab, a newly crowned king of Tanjung Baru, Hulu Terengganu, and was given the title of Sultan Zainal Abidin I, the first Sultan of Terengganu Sultanate. Due to Terengganu's historical background, a full of different types of architecture style. The uniqueness of traditional Terengganu architecture compared to other Malay traditional architecture is in its simplicity and functionality. Natural resources were utilized such as woods, bamboos, palm leaves, sago and bertam. The architecture of Terengganu is influenced by its local hot and humid climate, as such as architecture that should suit to the thermal comfort develop the high and steep roof to allow rain to pass down quickly, which at the same time prevents the water from entering the house. It is also commonly raised on stilts for protection from flood and wild animals. The house is oriented from east to west to help to reduce the amount of sunlight penetrating inside the building, and large openings are induced across ventilation, thus lowering the temperature inside the house. Terengganu architecture is also influenced by other regions and cultures. In the time of colonial influence, new materials such as glass and nails were brought in during the colonization era in Malaysia. In the context of Terengganu, the buildings constructed must be oriented towards the direction of Qibla before the development of the roads at the area. The Terengganu traditional house also shows the segregation of spaces to divide the men and women as recommended in Islamic teaching. The depictions of human and animals are also substituted with floral pattern and heart, as it is discouraged in the teaching of Islam. Emergence of various cultures is also inherited as varied and improved Malay culture. For instance, migration of people from Patani and Sumatra during the reign of Sultan Zainal Abidin I has brought the architecture of Patani and Jambi into Terengganu. And relationship of Terengganu with the Riau Archipelago has brought the culture of Riau in Terengganu, which is the architectural style of Limas Bungkus House. Masjid Abidin, or known as Masjid Putih, the White Mosque, is located in a strategic area where it is established to be the tourist attraction spot by the local government due to the existence of significant heritage buildings in the area. Located next to the Maziah Palace, Masjid Abidin serves as the state mosque of Kuala Terengganu. It symbolizes the existence of Islam in Terengganu since 300 years ago. The former owner of Masjid Abidin is the Royal Institute. However, after the World War II, all Malaya states, now known as Malaysia, were governed under the British government. British limit the power and the duty of Sultan, and the restructure of the government system separates the mosque from the center of the government. After the independence, Masjid Abidin is put under the protection and administration of Majlis Agama Islam dan Adat Melayu, Maidam. The development of Masjid Abidin is closely related to the royal families and the ulama Ahlul Bayt as royal advisor since the early period of Sultanate institution. The extension of the masjid is due to the increasing number of local people gathering for religious activities, such as classes, tadarus, and mainly to afford the jama'ah during congregational prayers. Hence, the masjid itself is being described as the center of community, learning, and even the center of government. There is also a cemetery for royal families and sultan around the masjid area. In the beginning, Masjid Abidin was established by Sultan Zainal Abidin II from 1793 until 1808. The first structural material used was cengal timber. Most of the material were donated or wakaf from the local people. The design components from its initial construction still exist until today. They are the calligraphy engraving, the green timber doors, and the six timber columns inside the main prayer hall. During Sultan Omar's ruling period in 1852, Masjid Abidin undergoes a significant renovation. The main building materials, which is timber, was replaced with concrete and red bricks, which were constructed with a mixture of honey, sand beach, limestone, lime, and white eggs. However, the renovation does not change the original space organization of the mosque, but adds additional number of domes. The changes of materials were influenced by Sultan Omar's experience traveling to British due to diplomatic reasons. However, the building's main roof features, the Senggoral tiles, remain after the renovation. After the ruling period of Sultan Omar, the domes were replaced with the new design of domes. The new domes were made from the Senggoral tiles, replicating the same feature of the existing roof tiles. In 1901, during the reign of Sultan Zainal Abidin III, Masjid Abidin went through a major expansion. The mosque was extended with additional corridors at the right side of main prayer hall. Sultan Zainal Abidin III was a pious leader of a government that was assisted by ulama. He sees the mosque as a major influence in expanding Islam to the society, even for the traders to teach and become the center of learning.
Ya, so zaman dulu lah, katanya sekitar ni rumah orang lagi. Ni terdah rumah orang.
With the addition of three-story towers, the mosque becomes among one of the largest structure during that particular period. The building used the same method of making mortar to bind the bricks. Famous colonization styles such as the column ornaments imitating the Doric ornaments, arches, vaults, and glass decoration were being infused with Malay traditional ornamentation of floral motifs. Masjid Abidin was able to sustain its original structure for 17 years before it was renovated again during the ruling period of Sultan Ismail Nasiruddin Shah in 1972. There was an addition of new structure at the right side of the prayer hall, which is bigger than the original size of the existing prayer hall. Elements of Terengganu traditional architecture were applied in its design. It also imitates the Masjid Negara Minaret, the additional fourth minaret, which is the highest minaret. The sutto and nine domes were also added on the new part of Masjid Abidin. In 2006, another renovation was made during Sultan Mizan's reign. Masjid Abidin has a symmetrical plan as it reflects a symmetrical facade treatment. Even with the odd numbers of towers, the positions were parallel with others, showing the elements of balance from the elevations. According to Cikgu Mat Ali, The facade design is an attraction due to its white color, contrasting with urban settings surrounding the mosque. Combination of rare materials like the colored glass is a decorative material which enhances the aesthetic value of the facade. The influences of colonial architecture started during the reign of Sultan Omar in 1852, whereas the whole building material has been replaced with brick except for the doors and windows. According to Ustaz Halim, the mausoleum caretaker, Sultan of that time has brought the influence of all church architecture, but all of the Christian elements and symbols were removed. In the beginning, the main prayer hall was similar to a Malay house, a square plan with columns supported, creating a space within another space. There was an addition space called serambi, similar to a traditional Malay house. This space is considered as an outdoors and open area with no wall, having less degree of enclosure. Later, when Sultan Omar renovated the masjid, the spaces of the main plans and the structure of the prayer hall were still preserved. The existing columns were still fixed in the position where the columns were initially constructed. Similar to the traditional Malay house, Masjid Abidin was also elevated 1 meter from the ground. The 7-step stairs connected the outdoor and serambi before another 3-step connects the serambi with the main prayer hall. Inside the main prayer hall, there is a recessed area from the main prayer hall that functions as mihrab. It is a space that functions to locate the direction of Qibla. After the decease of Sultan Zainal Abidin III, there was a mausoleum for him and his family. Later, on top of that mausoleum, 2 domes were constructed to demonstrate the special space inside the mosque. According to Ustaz Halim, a local researcher and former Bilal of Masjid Abidin, the structure of the mosque consists of load-bearing wall system. The load-bearing wall, which comprises red bricks with plaster finishing. The connection between the foundation to the wall is only connected by the layers of the red bricks. The column distribution system are influenced by the 6 columns, which represent the 6 pillars of Iman. The columns are said to be originally made from timber, but later were evolved by red brick wood for reinforcement. The original wall of Masjid Sultan Zainal Abidin was made from timber. After the renovation during the Sultan Zainal Abidin reign, the timber structure was then replaced with the concrete to further reinforce the building. However, after the renovation, the walls were plastered for aesthetic purposes. The roof of Masjid Abidin uses a hip roof with Chinese roof tiles, which are supported by timber rafter and purlins. The most domes are umbrella shaped, having 6 sides of octagonal domes fixed with the zinc sheets over it. Each side have a fixed window respectively that correspond to the colonial influence of the mosque. The floor tiles of the mosque are varied by spaces, mainly interior and exterior. After the renovation, the interior prayer hall was converted to the cement rendered with carpet finishing, while the exterior extension corridor floor was also cement rendered with marble floor finishing. Mainly, the doors are made from cengal timber, durable hardwood, and were decorated with ornamentation that had been inspired from floral and calligraphy motifs. Masjid Abidin has a variety of windows and opening designs. It varies from a simple window to a colonial style window. The uniqueness of this mosque is the artistry of carving Khat Al-Quran, supplication, and awalarat mounted above the doorway and the side of the mosque. Calligraphy carving at the main entrance was carved by Tengku Abdul Qadir bin Salim, while other smaller carving were done by Tuan Haji Abdul Rahman. The carving age is expected to be close to 112 years old since it was first built in 1901 during the reign of Sultan Zainal Abidin III. The minbar of the mosque is also carved with calligraphy. It is considered as an old relic of the mosque and its design is most alike with the other in Malacca. The age of the minbar is expected to be about 111 years since it was made in 1902 according to the carving dated on 1323 Hijri. Masjid Abidin remains as the center of the glorious institution of Islam and it also glorifies the Sultanate institution in Terengganu. The mosque has broadly evolved and adapted to the local context and also respond to the changes due to urbanization and modernization. This legacy of Islam should continue to be well preserved and conserved, historical proof as a guidance for the future generation.